So a typical house is a bearing wall type of house, which means solid walls hold up the roof. So you can have little openings, doorways, and so on. Everybody will recognize this. That's a typical house. An Eichler is post and beam construction. So instead of walls, you have frames. And that means all this space is free. And when you look at it in elevation, it means you no longer have these little pokey openings, like in a conventional house. But all this can be glass. And that's what makes an Eichler different.
In the years just after World War II, a former butter and egg salesman who had no experience in architecture or home building embarked on a career that would make him a legend. He began building what today are called Eichler Homes, or Eichlers for short. Originally priced under $10,000, the homes were aimed at the young families who were flocking to America's newest landscape, suburbia. Joseph Eichler built close to 11,000 modern tract homes in California, all but 600 of them in the San Francisco Bay Area. At first, people found the houses unsettling. They didn't even have front windows. Bankers wouldn't lend to buyers. Federal agencies refused to back the loans. Today, Eichlers are revered. There are people who will live in nothing but an Eichler. Owners spend tens of thousands of dollars restoring the houses to their original condition. Two Eichler neighborhoods are on the National Register of Historic Places. Many owners are self-confessed Eichler-holics. What makes these homes so compelling? Why are so many people so deeply in love with them?
I will never forget when I saw my first Eichler. I was driving down South Mary in Sunnyvale, and you know, you see these ranch houses, everything's normal, and you get to a spot where you see these flat roof spaceship looking homes, and I literally just stopped and I felt just this something coming over me. I had never seen homes like this before, and I didn't even know that you could build homes like this before. And I literally got out, grabbed some guy, he's like 65, he's walking his dog. I said, "What? Excuse me, can you tell me what these houses are?" And he knew. It was like this person just saw an Eichler for the first time. He said, "Oh yes, these are Eichlers, and a man named Joseph Eichler developed them all over the Bay Area." It's very special.
Eichlers have always appealed to a certain type of people, and that was true then as it's true now. At that time, they were so new, a lot of people didn't know what to make of them when they first saw them. Others saw them and they realized they were seeing something that they had previously only seen in magazines or among houses for wealthy people who could patronize architects. So they were mind-blowing at first, shocking, because they were so pure and so simple, and they didn't have the image, you know, of a traditional house. And if you talk to people who were selling back then, they said most people hated them. But the people who like them just love them.
The Eichlers are like living in a piece of art, I think. And it blends the shelter on the inside with the serenity of nature on the outside, so that it's more than just a residence. It's a fuller existence.
But it's not just an art form. It's not just a painting on a wall. It's an environment that you exist in. If you go in the backyard and sit in the chair and read, or you sit in here and read, or whatever it is, the experience is so great, you know, that, you know, if you lived in another place, you'd pay money to come here and sit in a chair and read a book because it's so relaxing and so enjoyable.
One of the things that really struck me after seeing so many pictures of Eichler's and hearing about like the inside outside nature of the house, there's nothing like when you actually live in it and you're able to see how like you can go so effortlessly from outside into the atrium and you're still outside, and then into the house and then back out. Like, I'll come home and, you know, within minutes I'm outside with him. And in fact, that's one of the great things about the open floor plan is, you know, we can be in the kitchen or what have you, and we have a view pretty much of the whole house.
Eichler homes make absolute common sense. The atrium, of course, was a marvelous innovation, and the atrium provides cross ventilation, light from two sides for almost every room, cross traffic patterns so that you don't have to enter the front door and go from there into other parts of the house. I could go on forever. Sometimes I lie on the floor in the living room and just look up at the ceiling. It's just a visual treat.
Eichler's were groundbreaking in lots of ways. First of all, the design. I mean, they're pure, elegant, simple pavilions with natural materials, but they're very simple and refined. But the way they live made them really desirable for people who were otherwise looking for more traditional buildings.
In the 60s, they were brand new and all of this stuff. And our family lived in an old house, and so my mom had antiques. And I just, you know, I appreciate what they were, but it just wasn't my thing. And so when I moved out on my own, I kind of wanted to go back and get in on the life I missed out on, because we were living in the, you know, 1800s in terms of, you know, furnishings and whatnot, and the house was built in 1876. This is the thing I discovered, is that you can live whenever you want. Just to parenthetically point this out, this house was actually designed in the late 50s. It was built in 1961, so, you know, most of what you see around here would have been made from about 1945, you know, that modern era. We try to make it so even doing mundane things in our house creates an experience rather than that you're just doing a certain thing. So everything from the switches in these houses, all of the Eichlers have a different kind of switch from what you'd normally encounter. So when you turn something on, there's an experience. You're doing something, wow, that's interesting. Or when you answer the telephone, it's not like answering a normal telephone in our house. It's an experience. And those kinds of things, just mundane things that you normally do, are transformed in this house to something different. Going to bed at our house is different. We have magic fingers. You put two quarters in the machine and it vibrates, and so every night we do that.
Eichler and his architects not only designed houses, they designed entire developments, sometimes incorporating community centers or parks. There are at least 50 Eichler developments in California. We visited homeowners in 7 of these developments in the Bay Area. In Castro Valley's Green Ridge development, we talked with an original owner and a couple who searched for 5 years to find their Eichler. We spent time with an owner in San Jose's Fair Glen, whose house is like a time warp going back to the 60s. And just across town, we visited an owner who grew up in the Fairhaven development and 30 years later moved back to start a family. In Palo Alto, we talked with owners who weren't even looking for an Eichler when they moved into the Green Meadow development. In Marin County, a Terra Linda homeowner has redefined her Eichler. Nearby, Lucas Valley Eichler owners have been active for decades in preserving the homes and land in their community. And the owner of a celebrated Eichler, the Life House, invited us into his home in the San Mateo Highlands. In an Eichler development, it's easy to make friends because all of your neighbors share a common architecture and lifestyle. The result is a rich community life rarely found in suburbia or anywhere.
We like that whole 1961 thing, but there's another thing about it. There's that old-fashioned kind of Midwestern sort of a feel to this neighborhood. We know everybody all the way down the street, all the way, all these different directions, and so the kids feel safe. The parents feel safe about the kids playing out in the yard and that kind of thing.
We found this house because of the neighborhood and the community. I was dropping my son off at the preschool across the street, and I saw the realtor putting the for sale sign on this property, and I jumped on it that day. But I like the feel of the community, and I like the neighborhood.
So we weren't seeking out an Eichler, but I think when we, after having visited a couple during while looking for houses, we began to appreciate them.
The way the neighborhood's structured, you've got the pool, the park, the kids went to the preschool across the street, and we have Cubberly Fields here, and it was just roaming around, seeing friends, and we're all just in this contained, you know.
But the neighbors' kids
blocks.
Walk in, yeah. And probably our kids too. They're friends, but it's pretty informal. So they'll walk into your house, you know, ringing the doorbells, an oddity.
They,
you know, they'll
often,
just kind of walk
yeah.
in and say, "Is Nick here?" Or "I'm going to go to Nick's."
Sometimes
room
you'd never hear a knock on the door, and you'd just say, "Hey, is Nick home?" Or "Is Nick?" Yeah. Or somebody would be in the garage going, "Oh, where's Katie? Where's Nina?"
Looking back on it, I remember it. Fondly, it was a nice environment, and it was nice house and nice neighborhood to live in, and you know, we had the good, there was a pretty large lot, so as a kid you've got lots of places to you know, to run around and play, and there's a pool and stuff. I think that stayed with me, that feeling that a lot of people get and that is appealing to a lot of people about Eichler Homes. I think that made an impression on me, and in particular living in that house with even more of that experience, I think it stuck with me, so.
Sort of like you're adopted into the Eichler clan, you're adopted into the area, and people, you know, as you're moving in, your neighbors are like sort of curious, and they find an excuse to walk their dog by and sort of like, "Oh, hi." I think that lifestyle is like stepping back in time to where people actually were a little more family oriented and a little more neighbor oriented. We know what's going on in people's lives. I love that about an Eichler neighborhood.
I've lived in other parts of Marin County, and I still to this day, I've owned homes. I never knew my neighbors. Here, it's like, immediately they had a block party for me. This is a little cul-de-sac. One of the neighbors invited everyone within the neighborhood, you know, I think within a mile. And they had a big party, they introduced me and made me feel very welcome. And to this day, they watch out for each other.
We have three houses of three generations right here on this court.
So, yeah. You know, it's very common from what I hear for children to come back to the neighborhood, but to have all daughters, incidentally, on the same cul-de-sac with their parents is pretty remarkable.
It's wonderful.
There's a sense of being social that kind of can come with the territory. And let's not forget that these homes were, you know, on the cover of Sunset magazine as the epitome of California living, that indoor, outdoor, you know, drinks around the pool, sort of California style. So they were designed for that flow of nature and flow of people, I think.
The other aspect of Eichler living is that it creates neighborhoods and camaraderie between the people who live in the Eichler subdivisions or neighborhoods. Everyone is so proud of their home. They respect their home. They honor their home. They are appreciative of what their home does for them. Not many people can say that.
It's really fun to live on the same street that I grew up as a child. A lot of people think it's strange that we ended up back here, but those people aren't Eichler owners. A lot of the neighbors are owners that have been here throughout my entire lifetime, people that moved in the early 70s. Many are original owners. So it's really wonderful to feel such a great connection to the community, and our children actually also benefit from that as well. They feel like they are surrounded by aunties and grandmas and grandpas and really love it, love feeling safe and cared for and really connected to something special. Like the block parties that we do, there's an annual block party here. I think, what, it's 35 years of 4th of July block parties. It's a really nice place to be. It's a great neighborhood.
San Jose's Fairhaven neighborhood has held a 4th of July block party and parade every year since 1976. Green Meadows celebration in Palo Alto has taken place for over 50 years. Many Eichler communities have a long tradition of some kind of annual block party. A crusader for good design and low-cost housing, Joseph Eichler also maintained a firm policy of non-discrimination. He sold openly to African Americans and Hispanics, while most builders prohibited minority buyers from their all-white developments.
I'm one of the original owners of these Eichlers in Castro Valley. I was one of 10 African American families that moved here in 1964. People don't remember that the United States was really segregated, fully segregated. And so we were from New York City, and we had driven across country and experienced a lot of real racist or, you know, uncomfortable events about just staying overnight, let alone living in a community. And so when we heard about this builder who was willing to let anyone who had some money to put down on a place come in and buy his 3, 4, and 5 bedroom tract houses. And normally tract houses were kind of donuts and little cookie cutter type things, but this felt like it was custom made for us, you know? Great big floor to ceiling glass windows and the redwood beams and this sense of indoor, outdoor, it was just something we had dreamed about, and we felt we would never ever be able to have that. It was just wonderful having that kind of opportunity at that time in that era. He was one of the first, I don't know of any other, that a builder who was saying, this is the time, you know? He took a stand with some other politically minded people in other businesses, but he took a stand about housing, and he said housing has a way of shifting that paradigm. And I think he did it as a marketing ploy for himself. He cut a niche for himself. He got the business because he was well known to do a beautiful design and to have a practical living space that it was absolutely stunning to look at. But he also was saying, and anybody else who has the money has a fair right to live in this place too.
Well, Joe, for whatever it was, loved having lived in a modern building, and he thought that would be a good product to have, you know. And the other thing about Joe that I think is germane to any discussion about why the buildings are what they are is that Joe was a pretty left-wing guy. He was the first, my understanding is that he was the first developer, first home builder in the United States to come out strongly in favor of fair housing.
His position on non-racial discrimination was phenomenal. And he was a voice in the wilderness at the time, and he was typically hard and harsh about it. He had the TV people there. Somebody was protesting who their new next door neighbor was, and he said, if you don't like it, I'll buy your house back. You're out of here. They're staying. Well, I loved that.
Our policies, we sell to anybody who's financially qualified to buy a house. We had sold a house for future delivery to a black lawyer from San Francisco. And the salesman, who was extremely positive about this, it was unusual, called me and said that the people who bought the house next door were coming out to look at their house while it was being built, and they saw this you know, black couple and looking at their house, and he asked the salesman. The salesman said, yeah, he said, they bought the house for when it gets finished. And he said, oh, and the guy blew up, and he said he couldn't talk him out of it, he's gonna call you. And he called me. And I just said, you know, I'm sorry. He says, well, then I want my money back. I said, we are not gonna give you your money back. Because if we give you money back, we're somehow admitting, you know, there's something wrong with this, and we're not gonna do it. and he hung up. And I, you know, I kind of forgot about it. 3 or 4 months went by. I never heard a word. I went, was walking by Molly's desk one day. I said, whatever happened to that? Oh, she said, the guy came here, his wife, they closed, they were happy. She said, I never heard a word about it. The people who bought Eichler homes would tend to be more open about this kind of thing than people who bought conventional homes.
A house full of new ideas in homes. That's the Eichler X100, a house for tomorrow, taking the pulse of today's prospective homeowner. Steel is used in columns and roof beams. One wall is paneled in glass. New plastics, everything so modern it takes your breath away. What's cooking in the kitchen? A lot more new ideas. For instance, a sliding table with built-in stove. You'll really feel at home on the range.
In 1947, there was a huge housing crisis. First of all, there had been the Great Depression, so during the 30s, home building had come to a virtual standstill. Then there was the Second World War, so monies devoted to construction were going into the war effort. After the war, you'd had this buildup of housing demand with no supply, and you had millions of veterans returning home and starting families. So suburbia, as we know it, was about to be born. And at the same time, it was a very socially progressive time, or at least there were progressive elements, particularly among architects, who understood this need for new housing and were looking to the building industry for opportunities to bring modern design to satisfy new home building and to bring good design to that product.
The vision of these architects was to build single-family homes of quality design that would be affordable to middle-class buyers. Small houses that felt spacious, with glass walls and atriums, unimpeded views of the outdoors, that offered privacy because the windows looked out the back into a yard, not the front. These architects were influenced by European modernists, Los Angeles architect Richard Neutra, and Frank Lloyd Wright. They promoted minimalism and an inner relationship with nature in home design. Joseph Eichler was drawn to these pioneering architects and their utopian vision.
Joseph Eichler became a builder almost by accident. He was an executive for a West Coast-based dairy wholesale company and lost his job during the war. But during that time, he was living in a Frank Lloyd Wright house called the Bazett House, one of Wright's Usonians, a small, compact, but beautifully designed house of brick and wood and big areas of glazing on the garden. And he was really inspired by it. And when he was thinking about what next to do in his life, he's 45 years old, mid-career, but out of a job. He knows there's a housing crisis, and he says, now there's an opportunity for a business. And so in 1946, he started a small home building business.
There was a guy named Joe Eichler. One day he walked into the office and he said, you know, I've gotten into this home building business. And asked us if we would like to participate. And we worked something out. We did a group of, our first job was in Sunnyvale, 60 little houses with the first ones. They were somewhat of a revelation, and Eichler was selling them right and left. And he was selling them to sort of an interesting clientele of mostly professional people. We worked on those things for a long time. We came up with endless different floor plans, designs, sizes. We also went through the interesting experience of being able to work continuously, let's say 12 years, with a builder, with his superintendent.
Eichler was an independent thinker and a marketing mastermind. He had insight into what buyers wanted, and what they wanted were homes with interior designs that matched the sleek beauty and innovation exhibited in their exteriors. To achieve this, Eichler hired Matt Kahn to serve as the interior designer for Eichler Homes. Kahn brought with him the unique aesthetic sensibilities and renegade spirit that made Eichler's home so special.
What my father did for Eichler Homes evolved from what he did for Eichler Homes, basically. So, but I think originally he was asked to design, in those days the term was probably used, to decorate the model homes. And he did it in a very special way. You know, he welded up constructs to reflect the notion of a fire in the fireplace, even though they were in no way mimicry of a fire. You know, they were made out of concrete reinforcing rod and stained glass. That there is a quality of sincerity in my father's work and in his approach to his work that was extremely important to him. It doesn't pretend to be something that it is not. It doesn't imitate something else. But he got into what he did and he turned it into something great, something that even he would not have known that it would have been at the beginning. In that way, that his whole tenure with Eichler Homes was very related to an idea, which is that the inspiration is in the doing. And Joe took advantage of it, and it grew. And they developed a special dynamic with each other.
Everyone relates iPods and all that to design. I mean, they're synonymous with design. And Eichler, you know, and Eichlers are the iPods and iPhones of the day. Eichler and Steve Jobs are very similar, sort of difficult characters, but they know how to manage talent, where talent itself doesn't know how to manage itself. When Steve Jobs walked through Xerox PARC, you know, he saw all these geeks and they all had this little stuff. They had no idea what they were inventing, but he was putting it all together. Eichler put it all together. You know, he knew an architect here that he had seen in magazines. He had experienced architecture through Frank Lloyd Wright. He knew about marketing. He hired the best marketing people. He knew how to manage talent, and that's what makes it work.
Eichler hired outstanding architects who shared his social philosophy. Robert Anchin, A. Quincy Jones, Claude Oakland, and others. They continually sought ways to improve their product. Jones would knock on doors in Eichler developments and ask owners for suggestions on how to improve the homes and neighborhood. Eichler and his architects were not motivated by profit alone. They were on a kind of crusade.
His relationship with Anchin was interesting. He was the first architect he hired, and he hired him to do his own house. And then Anchin looked at these homes he was doing on spec, and he hated them. He said, how can a guy like you who loves architecture build this crap? Anchin was very frank. And he said to Eichler, why don't you let me design the next subdivision? And Eichler said, you could never do it for my budgets. But they worked out an arrangement, and they built the next subdivision with 51 houses designed by Anchin, and they all sold out in less than 2 weeks.
Well, my father and Anchin, they fought a lot about all kinds of things. And Anchin was a very unusual person. He was small, very small, both short and slim, but his head was completely outsized to his body. He waved his hands around a lot when he talked. He had a very loud voice. And that thing with his hand shaking, he could draw absolutely marvelously freehand. So it was very strange. Once he started drawing, the shaking went away. But anyway, the thing with Anchin was that he and my father used to fight all the time. Totally different. Quincy was placid, and Anchin was a flamboyant person. I mean, he lived on a houseboat. He was really strange. And they had a fight, and they had a kind of divorce. You know, we just went on with Quincy. He would often take me and a couple of, you know, those, they had a construction, and a couple of people, we'd go to lunch. So we did that one day, and he said, oh, let's go see what Anchin's doing. This guy, Mac, I remember it was Mackie Holmes. And we drove up to this place, and Anchin was there. And here they finished the models, and they were building a few of these. And they really were lousy. I mean, they were these hybrids that were neither here nor there. And my father looked at it, and Anton came over to him. Big smile on Anton's face. "How are you, Joe?" And my father just, he said, "God damn it, Bob." He said, "You see, those are, you violated all the things. You would never let me do anything like this. You tell me it's wrong. I wouldn't do this." And Anton said, "Well, you wouldn't let me do it." And my father broke out into a big smile, and Anton was back designing houses. It was the perfectly seductive statement, "You wouldn't let me do it."
Some Eichler owners will go to great lengths to find just the right doorknob, house numbers, siding, paint color, furnishings, whatever they need to maintain the original design aesthetic of their home. They can be fanatical about it. Just ask them about remodeling or second story additions.
Joe hired a lot of professional architects and world-class people to put these things together. And it behooves some individual and his contractor to modify that.
We all live here. We're all in the Eichler Club, but we all live right together. So where do you get this thing, or how do you fix the roof, or what do you do with that? And, you know, so it's that kind of thing, and that's the camaraderie that I think comes just from the kind of house that it is and the architecture. So then when people come in and they have an idea to remodel it, they're not architects, and they usually mess things up. We used to go to open houses where they had really nice paneling, and then the real estate agent got the great idea that, oh, it'll open it up if we just roll it white. And it doesn't open it up, it closes it in, because the wood grain actually gives depth to the room and warmth to the room. But they think they're gonna, so they've destroyed it forever. You can never retrieve that, it can't be done. Don't destroy what, because they're fewer and fewer and fewer. Once they're gone forever.
The beautiful backdrop of hills north of the Lucas Valley development in Marin County might be overrun with houses if Eichler owners had not taken measures years ago. In 1972, they floated a bond and, over time, purchased 285 acres of open land. Their active preservation efforts created a strong community that has kept the land and neighborhood homes intact.
Originally, Eichler, his idea was to have them be in harmony with the environment and the hills, and to sort of take their place and not overwhelm the environment. Currently, the architectural review committee is a committee which is really concerned with community understanding and community involvement and a sense of working together with the community. So we all have the same goal in mind, which is to keep really these houses looking as pure and with as much of the original integrity as possible. And we, almost 10 years ago, created design guidelines, which were incorporated into the countywide plan, which discusses every architectural element and the possibilities for, what the modifications could be, every single element, fencing, landscaping, driveways, but a lot of times they're bigger issues. They come to us, we vote and decide if it's an important issue, and then we communicate with that person and try to resolve it.
Not everyone appreciates Eichlers. Some realtors think the homes are overhyped, that they're ripe for teardown. Others ask, why would you want to live in a box?
This home is like people can see into it. You think they can see into it, but it's subtle because they really can't see into it. It's the lighting and the landscaping. But with all the glass, people start to get paranoid about losing their privacy. But with this home, there is privacy, but it doesn't seem like there's privacy. It's mysterious.
Before I bought this home, I asked Eichler owners how they felt about Eichlers, and there were clearly problems. There was someone who said, "Marika, why would you buy an Eichler? They can immediately burn up if there's a fire, or the radiant heating doesn't work, or there's too much glass and the heat goes out and it's expensive to keep up." People look at homes that have flat roofs and say, "Oh my God, there's going to be problems with you know, water and drainage and so on. And I think, how sad that they look at, you know, what the problems may be when really all of that is solvable. All of those things can be fixed.
To many Eichler owners, the plain, simple architecture of their home is like a blank canvas that invites artistic expression. Some owners even redefine their Eichler from the ground up in a major redesign that extends the home's original aesthetic. These owners are taking Joseph Eichler's design into the 21st century and reimagining it for today's lifestyle.
There's artists, architects, engineers, creative people of all types seem to be drawn to them. And I think it's probably because they're not cookie cutter, they're not conventional, but there's also something about them that's liberating. The way that they don't have an imposing style and the way they let daylight in and they have open plans means you can kind of construct your own life inside them. So they're good for creative individualists who want to sort of make their own way of life. It's a good background for people like that.
Eichler's homes were burnished by a team of skilled salespeople with vast knowledge and great enthusiasm for the Eichler brand. One of the all-time greats among them was Catherine Munson, whose passion for Eichlers helped her earn the designation Queen of Eichlers. Her enthusiasm for the homes was infectious, and as a staunch advocate for all things Eichler, she was truly a beloved and respected figure in the Eichler community.
I often tell people when we have an open house that one time years ago when I was working with Joe Eichler, I spent a lot of time working with the marketing and the promotion and the advertising, and there was a huge amount of money spent by the Eichler Homes organization on advertising, much more than most other merchant builders spent, because Joe understood and the people who worked for him understood that this was a concept. We were not just selling houses, we were selling a way of life. So one of the evolutions of this marketing program was a series called Eichler Homes for Better Living. But the first time that it came out, a full page in the Chronicle, it came out with a typo, Eichler Homes for Better Loving. And we thought that was perfect. But he was a hard guy in that he was a tough taskmaster. He wasn't lenient with people. I loved it because he gave me and everyone else freedom. I liked the freedom to make my own mistakes. I liked the freedom to succeed. I thought he was very fair. It was a great experience in my life. It remains the greatest sort of an experience. It always will for me and for my family and for all the people who are lucky enough to live in an Eichler. Thank you.
Between 1949 and 1974, Joseph Eichler built 11,000 modern homes, and Eichler Homes received many design awards. Although he sold his business in 1966 after experiencing dire financial straits, Eichler continued building homes in a scaled-down way and under different company names until his death in 1974. By the mid-1970s, the vision that one day modernist modern homes and well-planned neighborhoods would become America's norm had died. Cookie-cutter suburbs flourished then and still do, along with today's monster homes and McMansions. But Eichler's influence continues. Eichler-style homes have surged in popularity, and the Eichler ethos has spread to a younger generation. Magazines, books, museum exhibits, and scores of websites are devoted to mid-century modernism. Eichler has become a legend, and his showcase homes still draw visitors from around the world. Most famous is the X100 in the San Mateo Highlands. Two blocks away is the Life House. In 1957, Life magazine commissioned Eichler to build a promotional house with a split-level design. The resulting feature story brought Eichler Homes a flood of publicity. Today, architects and students tour the Lifehouse. The merely curious park their cars across the street, look up at the house, and dream of living there.
It's like a big ego trip for me to have people come and look at the place. And I like to show them around, and I take a lot of pride in the home and in, you know, the fact that we've built it up. It's been a labor of love for the last so many years. I don't want to date myself. Now, so it doesn't bother me. I mean, I welcome it. Come, enjoy.
Notice these ideas that come together. Truth, goodness, beauty, right? That those things connect. And so if you live in a world where there's beauty and there's balance and all of those kinds of things, well, it creates a better life for you.
Eichler has quite a legacy. He built more modern houses than any other builder. And his ego was huge, and he really wanted to be a force in the building and design industry. So everything he did full on, and he never accepted second-rate quality. He thought of himself like Frank Lloyd Wright. He was that kind of a personality, arrogant, tough, but the legacy he leaves is remarkable. I mean, no one built that many quality modern houses in American middle-class housing. He stands alone.
The legacy is he's the man responsible for all this, called an architect, called whatever words people are choosing. That's the legacy, right? I mean, there's no other way to say it.
Harmony with nature, community spirit, practical design, neighborhood preservation. These words used by Eichler owners to describe their homes and communities provide insight into the Eichler phenomenon and why some people are so enamored of these homes. Living in and maintaining an Eichler is a lifestyle, or as one homeowner put it, an experience. On this journey to explore Eichlers, the people who have shared their enthusiasm in homes are keeping Joseph Eichler's vision alive with passion.
Yeah, I remember when I was a kid, you know, we'd stay in motels and, no, we're not spending a quarter on that.
So you were saying before thank you.